Okay, we'll start. Good afternoon to all my friends who have signed in to listen to this webinar. I'm Dr. O.C. Abraham from the Department of Medicine and Infectious Diseases at Christian Medical College, Vellore. On behalf of SIDS, I would like to welcome all of you to series three of SIDS hosted webinars, specifically on COVID-19. This series three is different from the first two series we had, because the highlights of this particular series is pro-con debates. Today we have a very important topic on pre-operative testing and making operation theaters COVID safe. I will hand over to our secretary, Dr. Nambi, to begin the proceedings now.
Very good afternoon, viewers. And we are on the COVID webinar done by Clinical Infectious Disease Society. This is the third edition, and we have come with a newer avatar in form of more of debates and less of lectures. And we have Dr. O.C. Abraham, who is the president of our society and who is a professor of medicine at Christian Medical College, Vellore. He will be delivering his mini lecture, 15 minutes lecture on making OT COVID safe. And then we would have a debate. It's a pretty exciting debate on should we do COVID PCR as a routine before surgeries. I think in most of the private hospitals, in tertiary care centers, it's been a practice to do COVID PCR, whereas in other institutes in type 2 or type 3 cities, or even smaller hospitals or in the government institutes, it's not a practice to do it. So what is the right thing to do? So for that, we have an exciting debate for which we have Dr. Vikas Deswal from Delhi, who will be speaking on the debate. And then we have Dr. Swati Gohil, who is again an ID physician from Ahmedabad. And they are the ones who are going to debate on it. And probably just like the debate that we had yesterday, which is a quite exciting one. And many people who are using N95, after listening to the debate, told me that they are now comfortable with the surgical mask. At least two or three people told me in person. So that is something that we could achieve, probably some cost cutting for the hospitals. And again, let us have something conclusive out of this pre-operative COVID PCR too. And with this, we are already some 2-3 minutes delay. I would hand over to Dr. O.C. Abraham to start his lecture on making OT COVID safe. Thank you.
Good afternoon once again, and thank you very much, Dr. Nambi. Thank you very much for the welcome message and organizing this very well-received series of webinars again. I have two disclosures to make before I begin my presentation. Number one, mine one is only a starter, appetizer. We have a very juicy debate. Two well-qualified, young, enthusiastic ID physicians debating the pros and cons of pre-operative PCR testing for COVID-19. Can things be more exciting? I don't think so. So mine is only a starting course. Second one, I'm acutely aware of the fact that I'm on alien territory. I'm going to talk about making operation theaters COVID safe. I'm not a surgeon, I'm not an anesthetist, the usual inhabitants of operation theaters, but I will speak from my background in internal medicine, infectious disease, and a little bit in infection control. This is the outline of my presentation. First and foremost, I will talk about administrative and engineering controls. In any infection control talk, these are the foremost things, administrative and engineering controls. This make our hospitals safe for people who work there, safe for people who come there seeking treatment, safe for the families of patients who come there by preventing opportunities for disease, infectious disease transmission within hospitals. So that's the most important thing. Number two, I will talk about pre-operative evaluation, one of which is pre-operative testing. You will hear more about it from Dr. Vikas and Dr. Swati. And my final talk will be on intraoperatively, what all can you make to make sure that the operating rooms are safe. To start off with administrative and engineering controls, these are measures to ensure high quality and safe surgical care. This makes sure that there are there is no transmission, or we keep it to a minimum, transmission of pathogens within the hospital to healthcare workers and patients and their families. So let's start with planning surgery. For elective surgeries, every hospital in the middle of a pandemic should have some risk stratification based on these following criteria. Number one, indication and urgency of the procedure. So if the procedure can wait, if the patient can be managed non-operatively in the middle of a pandemic, which intensely resource intense, meaning you are in the middle of a pandemic looking after sick patients with COVID-19, so you would like to postpone surgeries which can be postponed without harming the patient, which can be managed non-operatively and compared operatively. Next thing is resource utilization. Planning this surgery, going ahead with the surgery, how much resources are needed in terms of personnel, operating room, anesthetists, blood products, ICU beds, etc., etc. So it's good to sit down, have a team, look at all these three indications and plan some kind of risk stratification system. Then the most important, infection control precautions. As all of us are aware, isolation precautions for all COVID-19 patients, they include the standard precautions, droplet precautions, and contact precautions. And whenever you are engaged in any activity which generates aerosols, you have to also have airborne precautions. Appropriate PPE should be made available, and all staff should be trained in appropriate use of this PPE, when to use, how to use, how to don, how to doff, etc. Particularly pertaining to operating rooms is the issue of ventilation, ensuring that all operating rooms conform to current standards of adequate ventilation. As most of us are aware, NABH recommends 20 air changes per hour in operating rooms today. Pre-operative evaluation, if the patient is symptomatic, symptoms which are highly suggestive of COVID-19, or has history of contact with the patient who is a lab, who has a laboratory confirmed COVID-19, it's always the policy should be to defer elective surgery for at least a period of 2 weeks. Asymptomatic patients, do you test them or not test them? We are going to hear more about it a little later. There are three reasons why we test asymptomatic individuals, particularly asymptomatic individuals. Number one, diagnosing asymptomatic infection. Does it have any impact on patient outcome following surgical procedures? Does it have any impact on healthcare worker safety? And most importantly, we are going to face shortages of PPE, valuable PPE, in the middle of a pandemic. So if you know the test result, can we rationalize the use of PPE? I will just touch upon patient outcomes and the tests in a little while. So whenever we come talk about patient outcome, patients who undergo elective surgical procedures and patients who are asymptomatic, so operated during the incubation period of COVID-19, how does it affect ultimate patient outcomes? This is a series from Wuhan in China. 34 asymptomatic patients who developed COVID-19 following elective surgery. The mortality was 21%, and 44% of the patients needed ICU care following the surgery. But there are many problems in this study, which makes it difficult to generalize this result. Number one, this is only a case series. There was a lack of a control group. The sampling frame was not mentioned in the study. The pre-operative evaluation protocol was not mentioned. What kind of screening did these patients have before surgery? And these were elective surgeries done during the middle of a pandemic. So obviously the care for other kinds of patients would have been compromised. So to me, it looks like a cherry-picked case series. So yeah, this is certainly a matter of concern. Mortality of 21%, ICU care 44% following elective surgery. But are these generalizable results? We will have to wait for more data. And more data will hopefully come from the COVID surge study, which is an international study. Patients recruited from 125 countries across the globe, North America, Europe, Africa, and Asia, more than 9,500 patients. They have published the results from initial 1,100 patients in available in YouTube. The references are in my slide. they basically looked at post-operative mortality within 30 days and pulmonary complications, pneumonia, ARDS, and need for mechanical ventilations in patients with perioperative COVID-19. COVID-19 diagnosed 1 week before surgery or 30 days after surgery. The 30-day mortality was 24%. Pulmonary complications was 38%, certainly alarming. And just like other patients, men aged more than 70 years undergoing emergency surgery had the highest risk. This manuscript apparently has been accepted for publication in Lancet, and we will eagerly await the results of final published results from this study. What about diagnostic testing? Today, the standard of care is RT-PCR from respiratory samples. This is a very good test to diagnose, confirm the diagnosis among symptomatic individuals. As you know, any diagnostic test, you have to know the sensitivity and specificity. Those are the performance characteristics. You also have to know the pre-test probability of the condition in the patient you are seeing. So this is a very good test to diagnose, confirm the diagnosis in symptomatic diseases. So this is the current reference standard. This point was emphasized by Dr. Rajiv Soman in his presentation during the series one. How about using it as a screening test during incubation or asymptomatic phase of the illness? Unfortunately, we don't know the negative predictive value. Is it a good test to rule out COVID-19 in asymptomatic individuals? Unfortunately, this test has never been compared against a reference standard. In fact, we don't have a reference standard, so we don't know that. What about a CT scan of the thorax? This is what a CT scan of a thorax will look like in a patient with COVID-19 and respiratory distress. However, these changes are neither sensitive nor specific. Remember, changes will develop only in patients who develop pneumonia or lower respiratory tract involvement. More than 80-85% of the individuals have mild illness, no pneumonia. So ECT will look normal in them, nor are these changes specific. Diffuse ground glass opacities, the long list of conditions which look like this. So this is a statement from UpToDate. Routine screening CT for diagnosis or exclusion of COVID-19 is not recommended by most professional organizations and CDC. What about anesthesia and surgery? If the patient is proven to have COVID-19 or highly suspected to have COVID-19, symptoms and signs suggestive of COVID-19, you are awaiting, you have sent the test result, results are not back yet. This patient should be operated in a designated operating room, specifically set apart for COVID-19. It should not be brought into the general OR at all. There have been talks about universal respiratory precautions in OT. What do you mean by that? In the middle of a pandemic, every patient is assumed to be having COVID-19, and therefore you would treat every patient as potentially infected and potentially infectious. Therefore, the entire team will use the full airborne precautions. Good idea. The problem will be how much of resources, especially PPE, will be available to you. Once you have decided to operate on this patient, the protocol is that most experienced anesthetic wearing appropriate PPE. That will include a fit tested N95 mask and a face shield along with gown, gloves to perform the intubation. People have devised, as you can see in this recent New England Journal publication, protective barriers which enclose the patient's head for intubation. One example is an aerosol box. This has not been formally tried out to look at the safety and ease of use. After publication of this correspondence, there have been queries about ease of use of this one, whether this is really safe, will it increase the risk of transmission within the operating room, etc., etc. So this is one potential strategy which has to be validated. The professional societies now recommend both video laryngoscopy and rapid sequence for intubation of these patients. Use of HME filters is another way, like shown in this diagram. You have an HME filter between the airway and the circuit, and another filter at the expiratory end of the circuit. So these are other measures which can reduce the generation of aerosols and contaminating the operating room environment. So to sum up, every institution should risk stratify based on facility capacity and capabilities, whether they are compromised in the middle of a pandemic. If not, is the surgery urgent, in which case anyway you have to go ahead with the surgery. This is immediately life-threatening, need surgery to save the life. If it's an essential indication, you look at the patient has, whether the patient has symptoms and signs suggestive of COVID-19. If so, you delay or cancel the case. If not, you go ahead and then risk stratify the patient. The routine preoperative evaluation and ASA classification, and based on the results of the ASA classification, you make the decision to go ahead with the surgery. And in the OR, I talked about precautions during intubation and subsequent management of an anesthetized patient. And after surgery, COVID-19 positive patients should be transferred to designated ICUs and not to the general ICU. I'll end my talk and I'll hand it over to Dr. Vikas and Dr. Swati to go ahead with the debate. Thank you. It's going to be Dr. Vikas first or Dr. Swati first?
Shall I go first?
Yeah. Sure. So who is going first? Swati, are you going first? Or?
Yeah, I assume so, sir.
Okay, sure. Swati then.
Sure. So my slides are visible. Shabina, I assume my slides are visible.
Yes, doctor.
Yes, they are. Yes, they are.
Yeah. Very good afternoon to everyone. I'll be talking for universal testing for making OT COVID safe. First of all, would like to thank SIDS and Dr. Nambi for the opportunity. I have certain disclosures to make. I will be talking for ideal versus practical solutions. And I'll be using best of available literature and knowledge to support universal testing and help all clinicians to take proper decisions for their cases. I don't have any conflict of interest to disclose. I would like to start my talk with one case. This is a real case scenario which has happened in my own city in a local hospital. So here we had, here they have a 60-year-old gentleman without any comorbidities. This happened around 4 or 5 weeks back. That was in a middle, first or second week of April, where we had just started seeing sudden surge in cases. He didn't have any comorbidities. There was no history of any sick contact travel. So considerably initial screening was negative. Patient was admitted with the neck femur fracture. Patient was admitted in the general ward and he got operated 2 days after admission. Later on, he gave a history that his brother started running fever and found to be COVID-19 positive. Now comes the thing. So as per the ICMR protocols, ICMR testing regimen, which were available at that point of time, he was tested for the same and found to be positive, but he was asymptomatic despite of being 60-year-old. Later on, two resident doctors from the same unit who came in close contact with that patient turned out to be positive. Total of 10 resident doctors. This is the best of available knowledge we have. We didn't get any official data published from that hospital. Few of the nursing staff and few of the housekeeping staff were quarantined after this single incident. And this is a real time scenario. Subsequent days, they found few more positives and ultimately they had to shut down the hospital in the middle of the pandemic. This was the hospital who was taking care of the general public. This was one of the government hospitals. So this everything happened because of this single event, or there may be many more asymptomatic carriers who were coming to the hospital that we don't know. So questions: could it have been prevented? Can we afford to lose healthcare workers during COVID pandemic? I suppose no. And can we afford to lose hospitals by creating red zones for transmission during pandemic? I guess no. So today, after listening to Dr. OC, and anyway, I'm always admire him for his sticking to the basics. I'm going to start with the very basics. So for any disease epidemiology, we have to consider three factors: agent, host, and environment. Here, our agent is novel coronavirus, SARS-CoV-2. I'm not wrong in saying that we are still in learning phase. Every day we are learning something new about the thing. We have not seen literature changing so fast for any of the diseases before. And the second thing which is well proven is this SARS-CoV-2 has high infectivity rate as compared to other coronavirus. Now there are certain host factors which we need to consider is susceptible population. Now, being a novel nature of the virus, we don't have immunity to fight against virus until unless we are getting it by natural immunity or by vaccination, which is not going to happen in a near future. So basically, we have all good amount of susceptible population. Second is asymptomatic carriers. This is very important part. This population has played a very important role in spreading the pandemic. And another host population which we need to consider is patients with comorbidities, because they have been documented high morbidity and mortality in this subclass of patients. Now, environment. Here we are talking about operation theaters. That's our local environment, which we are going to discuss today. So we need to understand there is a difference between the community transmission, hospital transmission, and OT transmission. OT transmission, these are the high-risk areas for transmission of respiratory infections. Why? Because here we are not doing routine ward rounds. Here we are managing everything in a bit of urgency. So there is a urgency in the management. There is involvement of multiple staff in the close proximity. And there is high transmission risk activities such as airway management. So we have to be very stringent in whatever we try to implement to save our these key zone areas during pandemic. So these are the questions. Now, what are the options we have? So I suppose you all will agree that we can't do anything per se for the agent. Ultimately, the whole world has understood that we have to learn to live together. There is no way out. Let's see what we can do for the host factors. So shall we postpone? See, only way to prevent infection is to keep the agent away from the host. That is by postponing all elective surgeries. But can we actually separate this in case of oncology surgeries? What collateral damages we are putting on these patients by postponing all the surgeries? Until how long we are going to postpone? Second, if we are not considering the elective surgeries and routine surgeries, we have to take care of emergency surgeries and urgent surgeries. We don't have option for that. So again, we have to consider this three host population, that is healthcare workers, asymptomatic carriers, and incubating patients during the surgery. So what we can do? Dr. OC sir has nicely mentioned what basic engineering control measures we can take in the hospital, like separate COVID OT, negative pressure room, disinfection protocols after the procedure, single procedure at a time in a OT complex which shares single air handling unit, healthcare worker PPE, including everything. But is it possible? Can we transit our OTs from non-COVID to COVID so fast? Is it in our hands? I doubt. So what I'm going to attack in this epidemiology is host factors. That is what we can do with available resources. Now, sir has mentioned very important thing. In the hospitals, in the community, now we have started saying that let's consider everyone as COVID suspect and take universal precautions for all. That is feasible for the community, for the OPD area, for the ward area. But is it possible for the surgical operation theater room? I don't feel so. Because if we start implementing universal precautions, full PPE, separate air handling units, negative pressure rooms, I don't think we are able to survive this period. So we have to come up with the logical and practical solutions rather than the ideal solutions. And here, I would like to say known enemy is always better than the unknown. And now, as we know a bit about this enemy, I think we should try to find the enemy and then target all our precautionary measures against it rather than doing it universally. So what are the, I very well know that testing asymptomatic surgical candidates has its own flows. Like it differs between the countries and continents, depending on which phase of the transmission that country or the continent is facing. It depends on the underlying prevalence rate. Currently in India, certain cities have entered into the community transmission, certain cities have not. So this again depends on the underlying prevalence rate. We have to consider false negative rates of the tests. What operation types we are talking about, it's a high risk or low risk. Timing of the test. There are so many factors which are we have to address. But as I said repeatedly, we are looking for practical solutions. Chief executive of WHO said that we cannot fight a fire blindfolded. And now we very well know that this virus can infect anyone, can result in transmission even before the onset of symptoms, and sometimes even without the transmitting person developing any symptoms at all. So these are the very important host population that we have to consider. Right, in my case, patient's brother was an asymptomatic carrier who transmitted the disease. Patient came to the hospital. They took the history, screening, everything. He turned out to be negative from that screening, but ultimately that event led to shutdown of the hospital. So asymptomatic carriers are everywhere, well proven. Let it be Princess Cruise Ship, where the asymptomatic carriage was 17.9%. Let it be asymptomatic screening of pre-delivery women, which happened at two hospitals in the New York City, which again they found that 87.9%, approximately 88% had no symptoms of COVID-19 at presentation. Again, we know this on April 1st, 2020, China just released their ratio of asymptomatic to total positive, and they found that on a single day, out of 166 positive cases, that 78% of cases were asymptomatic. And again, this is a very nice modeling, temporal dynamics in viral shedding and transmissibility of COVID-19. And what they found is 44% of the secondary cases were infected during the pre-symptomatic stage. So here we are discussing about separating asymptomatic carriers from the susceptible host in a community setting. Then how can we allow this asymptomatic carriers in the hospital? So, and second point which I would like to stress upon is surgery during incubation period. We have good study. This one study has already quoted by Dr. O.C. Abraham, 34 patients, and they were incubating while they underwent elective surgery, and the mortality was approximately 20%, with the 44% of the patient required ICU admission. They were quite sick. Another study, it's a retrospective study of 25 cases from single thoracic unit surgery department. And the interesting data from, this is again from the China, Wuhan, the data was out of 25 patients, 12 patients were healthcare workers. So here we are losing healthcare workers in the hospital. Here again, the severe disease was found in 36% of patients and mortality was 20%. Another analysis which combines all the available evidence, they found that overall post-operative mortality rate in patients who are incubating at the time of surgery was 27.5%. Although all these studies have limited number of patients, but the mortality rate is unacceptably high, and the rate of complications are very severe. So it is a time for a global consideration of sampling all asymptomatic patients before surgical treatment. Various guidelines, let it be Society of Gynecology Oncology of US, let it be endoscopic surgeons guideline, let it be anesthetist guideline, they all say preoperative patients should be tested for COVID-19 regardless of their symptoms or exposure. what is the rationale? I am discussing this. I have discussed throughout my presentation. Here we are ensuring the patient's safety and reducing the post-operative complications, because we see that we saw that patients who are incubating at the time of surgery, they have really, really bad prognosis. We are preventing potential transmission of infection to the healthcare workers as well as co-patients. And thus, we are trying to prevent losing on our hospitals and losing on our healthcare workers. This is another study which is published in a British Journal of Oromaxillary Surgery. Again, they use PCR plus antibody testing. We don't have, as of now, much evidence for antibodies, or the reliable kits are not there in the country. So I'm not going to stress upon too much. But again, they are doing routine pre-op PCR testing for all the patients. This is again a study from China. What they did was, because looking into the sensitivity of the test PCR, which is available, they tried combining double PCR for the high-risk patients. That thus increasing the sensitivity. One small study from India, that is emergency and urgent orthopedic surgery in non-COVID patients during the COVID pandemic. This was a study was published from Mumbai, a very small study, only 18 emergency patients. All patients requiring surgery underwent two pre-surgical COVID RT-PCR to detect asymptomatic carriers or incubating patients. None of the patients detected positive in post-op follow-up. In some of the cases, they used additional CT and serological tests. So I know that our flows in available data, whatever data we have, it says it is very small available number of publications. We don't have control group, but whatever morbidity and mortality they have shown is unacceptable. And very important take-home message, what I would like to give from this study is that most of these studies which lost patients as well as healthcare workers, they were done before in the very initial time of the pandemic, where we were not aware who is our enemy. But now, as we know a bit more about our enemy, the virus, why not by implementing universal pre-op PCR, pick up such patients? Let it not be 100% sensitive, but let us pick up 70% of the patients and preserve our healthcare staff, other patients, as well as the patient who is undergoing surgery. Benefits of universal testing is not only for the patient, physical loss or healthcare worker getting infected, but it has a great psychological impact on operating surgeon and anesthetist also, because it will help them in taking better decisions. And eventually it eases the answering risk versus benefit ratio of operating versus not operating on that patient. So I would like to end there. I would like to stress upon that universal testing is the way to go ahead. Now, as we know our enemy, let us fight by removing the blindfold from our eyes. So I would rest here by supporting universal testing.
Thank you very much, Swati. Very well argued. Everything I mentioned at the beginning of my talk, very good review of the literature, rational and practical suggestions, why you would take the position of universal screening. Now we will hear from Vikas about rebutting, about trying to his view on preoperative testing. Over to you, Vikas.
A very good afternoon to all. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. O.C. Abraham and Dr. Senthu Nambi for giving me this opportunity to talk here. I would be speaking on pre-surgical COVID PCR targeted testing. And this would be the outline of my talk. I have divided my talk into various parts, and I would be asking questions to myself as well as Dr. Swati, and would try to look at scientific solutions to those problems. Sometimes I would deviate from the scientific solution and try to look for practical solutions. So first question which I would ask myself is, why are we testing? Why do we need to test everyone who's asymptomatic coming for surgery with a PCR? Next thing which I would like to do is understand what are the test characteristics, what is the pre-test probability, what is the sensitivity, what is the negative predictive value. Third thing which I would like to understand is what is the optimal timing of the test, because the disease is so dynamic and the disease has so large incubation period and an asymptomatic period in which we don't know when where the patient actually is lying at that moment. Fourth thing which I would like to stress upon is the universal testing strategy cost effective or it is not? Next, I would conclude my talk with some guidelines which are in my favor, although most guidelines are against me, and also would give a case scenario to Dr. Swati to ponder upon. So the question one which I wanted to ask myself is, why are we testing? Are we testing it for the safety of the healthcare worker? Are we testing it for the safety of the patient who is undergoing surgery? Or are we testing it for environmental safety because we are worried about the hospital contamination and furthermore hospital getting closed because of that? So first question, are we testing it for safety of healthcare worker? I would like to answer with this study which was published in Lancet recently and came from England. In this study, there were the healthcare workers rather were subdivided into three groups who were taking care of the COVID patient. Patient group one was those who were directly involved in the care of the patient, that is those who were patient facing. Patient group two was non-patient facing. Patient group three was those who were healthcare workers who are involved in non-clinical care in the hospitals. So in this study, they found that the rate of infections was almost similar in all the three group of the patients. Rather, it was slightly higher in the non-clinical group. And the odds ratio were also not statistically significant in the various groups. So with this, I can safely conclude from this study that the PPE and the infection control practices to a large extent prevent the nosocomial transmission of infection from an infected patient to a healthcare worker. So with this, I can safely say that healthcare workers are absolutely safe. We do not need to do a COVID PCR before surgery for the safety of a healthcare worker if he is correctly following the infection control practices. So next, are we doing it for the safety of the patient? The second question was that. I guess this study has been quoted by everyone and this study sort of goes against me, but I would try to dissect it in my favor. This is a study of only 34 patients and this was done in asymptomatic patients during a pandemic who underwent surgery for a routine procedure. Now I want to ask everyone, how many of you would make a recommendation based on a study which is only of 34 patients and is retrospective in design and there is no control group in that? Also, we are not aware of the protocols which were followed to screen these patients before the surgery. Also, very important to note here is that in this study, the median time to onset of the symptoms was 5 days after the hospitalization or after the admission. Whereas during the same time when the epidemic was going on in the Wuhan, the median time of infection or of exposure to the symptom onset was 4 days. These patients very well could have got infection in the hospital from the from the co-patient, from the doctor, from the nurse, or from any other healthcare worker. In fact, in the same study, three patients were excluded because they were either visited by a surgeon or operated by a surgeon who himself was COVID positive. So that's that is the basis. Do we rely on the study to make a recommendation? The answer to that from my side is no. But IDSA sort of and other guidelines have sort of taken the study very seriously and have made the basis of their guidelines and are most guidelines recommending universal testing before surgery. Also, we are not clear what is the complexity of the surgery. I was trying to look into the supplementary literature of this study and found that around 60 to 80% were in the complex grade 3 or 4 in this group. And the operating time in those patients was around 4 hours. So the poor outcomes in this study could very well be because of the complex surgery. And again, I would like to conclude that this, on the basis of this study, would you develop a recommendation? The answer to that from my side is definitely no. And I hope the answer from most of you also would be no. So the next question which I wanted to answer was, are we doing it for the environmental safety? The answer to that question came from this study, in which they tested various surfaces in an infected patient's room who was clinically infective as confirmed by a nasopharyngeal test. And they found that 17 of the 28 environmental samples taken from various parts of the room, washroom, and the door handles and the ante room were positive before cleaning. But the most reassuring thing is that all the surface sample taken from the same room, washroom, and door handles after the appropriate cleaning with 1% sodium hypochlorite were negative. So that's very reassuring to everyone. So the next question which I want to answer to ask myself and to ask Dr. Swati is, do PCR positivity equals to infectivity? The answer to this question was provided by this literature review from the Nature. In this, if you look at the graph on the right hand side, you can see that the PCR is positive in large number of patients by various methods up to even up to day 26 or day 28. Whereas if you look at the culture is only positive up to day 8. There are no culture positives after day 8. And there were no cultures which were done before day 3. So we don't know what the culture positivity or what the infectivity would be there in an asymptomatic patient who's coming to us for a surgery. So a little more from the same Nature article. Virus was isolated during the first week of symptoms in 16% of the throat swab was the nasopharyngeal swabs and 83% of the sputum samples. No isolates were obtained from the samples taken after day 8 in spite of ongoing high viral loads. No cultures in the study were done before third day. And I don't know whether we can equate PCR positivity with infectivity. Probably more studies are needed on to answer that question. So next I come to the characteristic of the test. And I trained in Christian Medical College, Vellore, and every Thursday on Grand Rounds, I was asked this question by Dr. O.C. Abraham, who's the moderator in the debate himself. What is the pretest probability of the test? What is the sensitivity and specificity of the test? Is the test cost effective? Now, the same principles I am going to apply to the available test for diagnosis of COVID-19 at the moment. So to know the pretest probability, we need to know the prevalence. And the prevalence here, I mean the prevalence in the asymptomatic individuals because we are testing asymptomatic individuals. Now, to my knowledge, I could not find any population-based study which documented prevalence of COVID-19 infection in asymptomatic individuals. This was the only study from Iceland in which what they did was they divided the population into two groups. One was the targeted group and one was the random population sampling group. The targeted group was the one who had symptoms or were a high-risk contact of the positive cases. And in the targeted group, the positive the number of positive cases were 13.3%, whereas in the non-targeted or the random population sampling, the percentage of positive patients was 0.8%. And to everyone's surprise, although their population is hardly around 5 lakhs, they tested 6% of total population. So a little bit on Indian epidemiology, except for most parts of India, other than Gujarat, Maharashtra, and to a large extent, Tamil Nadu, most parts of India have a very low number of cases per million. Look at states like Chhattisgarh, Bihar, Uttar Pradesh, Haryana, Himachal Pradesh, Uttarakhand, and the Northeast, where the prevalence of cases is hardly 10 cases per million. So I don't know what is the prevalence of asymptomatic cases in that area. And also, we all would agree from our clinical experience that in the last 2-3 months since this COVID-19 epidemic has started, we are not seeing any exorbitant numbers of unknown pneumonias or SARIs in our ICUs. And also, we are also not seeing any exorbitant increase in the number of deaths due to any medical reason. So with this, I can safely say that our testing strategies at this moment are sort of optimal at this point. This is just the Indian epidemiology's continuation of that. Now, little more on understanding the test characteristics of our SARS-CoV-2 PCR. This is a study which was published in JAMA in the United States, and 117 pairs of nasopharyngeal and oropharyngeal specimens from 12 patients were tested simultaneously. The nasopharyngeal specimen tested positive in 66% of those pairs compared with 34% for the oropharyngeal specimen. So the test is not foolproof and it misses out a lot of cases. So the sensitivity is not great for the test. This was another study which during the time of pandemic done in China, and they tested compared various types of respiratory samples for the positive predictive nature of that test. In that they found that the proportion of the positive tests were 93% in the bronchoalveolar lavage sample. There were 72% positive cases in the sputum sample. In the nasal swabs, it was 63%, and in the pharyngeal swabs, it was only 32%. So the nasal swabs and the pharyngeal swabs, which we routinely use for screening, are not foolproof. They are missing out a lot of asymptomatic cases. So this was as another study which was done to evaluate the accuracy of different respiratory specimens in the laboratory diagnosis, and they also monitored the viral shedding in different respiratory samples. So the study was conducted during the pandemic by CDC, China, and Guangdong. 866 samples from respiratory tract of 213 patients were taken at various points of time, and their proportion of positive cases were stratified according to the time, from day 0 to day 7, from day 8 to day 14, and beyond day 15. And not to our surprise, it was found that only the proportion of positive cases in the mild cases was 61% in the first week. For throat samples, for nasal samples, it was 72%. Look at the drop in the number of proportion of positive cases when we move to second week. It is 29% for the throat sample in the mild cases, and it is 53% for the nasopharyngeal sample. So I don't know, there are no studies to establish the proportion of positive tests or sensitivity of the test in asymptomatic individuals. So do we really want to use a test which performs so poorly even in the symptomatic patients when they move to the second week of the illness? I don't know the answer to that question, actually. I want to ask this question to my colleague or my co-debater, Dr. Swati. Why do the tests perform poorly in the second week of illness? The answer to this was provided by this Nature review. We can clearly see that the viral loads dropping sharply when we move into the second week of illness. The maximum drop is around day 8, day 9. And that is probably the reason why the test performs poorly in that time frame. So we do not know the viral load dynamics in an asymptomatic patient or a pre-symptomatic patient. So we cannot use a test which performs so erratically at different time scales for which we have available literature. For an area for which we do not have available literature, how can we extrapolate things from the available literature, which is very poor, to an area which is sort of gray as of now? Now, what does the IDSS say about the sensitivity of this test? If you do a single test, the sensitivity is 71%. If you repeat the test, the sensitivity is 88, goes up to 88%. Now, by doing a single RT-PCR, we would have probably false negative as high as 29% of the cases. So when you do repeat tests, you are diagnosing 17 additional cases. Now, here I want to ask my co-debater that, would you repeat a test because you are missing out on 17 cases in an asymptomatic individuals out of the 100 tested? So that's a big number. And also the IDSA guidelines do not mention of the test characteristic in the asymptomatic individuals. The third major question which I want to ask myself and Dr. Swati is, what is the optimal timing of the test? We do not know in what phase of illness a patient is who has come for an elective surgery is. He may not be exposed, he may be exposed, he may be in incubation period, he may be having asymptomatic disease. So how can we do a test in an asymptomatic individual who has such a wide spectrum of illness when he is asymptomatic or is not even exposed to the disease? So let's look at the CDC's interpretation of the test. This is even more baffling. If you have a positive test, then it's fine. You have COVID-19 illness. If you have a test negative for COVID by viral test, you probably were not infected at the time your sample was collected. However, that does not mean you will not get sick. This test result only means that you did not have a COVID-19 at the time of testing. Suppose we do the test today, it is negative, he was in a pre-symptomatic phase, or the viral load was pretty low for the range of detection, and everyone is happy and everyone is gaga, and the surgeons and the anesthetists both are happy, and even the ID colleagues are happy that the patient is negative. Now we can save the PPN, we can take the patient to the theater. But 3 days later in the theater, after the surgery, he developed symptoms, he is found to be COVID positive. Now what? We were right because we had done everything, whatever was needed as per the guidelines. We did a COVID PCR, which was negative before surgery. How can this happen now? This is probably the reason that's why it can happen. The test result only means that you did not have COVID-19 at the time of testing. It does not mean that you cannot have disease 3 days later, or a PCR test which is positive 3 days later. Now, what are the various fallacies of this test? Various respiratory samples perform in a different way at different times of illness. The sensitivity of the test at best is 71% in nasopharyngeal swabs. There are high rates of false negatives. There is no data on test performance in asymptomatic or pre-symptomatic individuals, and the negative test does not rule out an infection. So do we still want to use this test in an asymptomatic individual? I don't know the answer. Probably Dr. Swati can answer this. Now let's look at the IDSA guidelines. I know these guidelines are against me, but I would try to dissect them for myself, for my benefit. So IDSA recommends, IDSA panel suggests for SARS-CoV-2 RNA testing in asymptomatic individuals who are undergoing major time-sensitive surgery. Look at the strength of this recommendation. I know we all have been reading IDSA guidelines for long. Have we ever taken a recommendation seriously, which has a very low certainty of evidence, and it's a conditional recommendation? I don't think so. We need to take this recommendation very seriously with the current available evidence. Now let's look a little deeper in the remarks given by the IDSA recommendation for this recommendation. So the decision about PPE use for aerosol generating portions of these procedures may be dependent on the test results when there is a limited availability to the PPE. However, there is a risk of for false tests, which the CDC also says. So the caution should be exercised by those who will be in contact with exposed to the upper respiratory tract. Meaning, in simple words, we need to wear PPE even if the test is negative, if you are doing an aerosol generating procedure. That's how I interpret it. The decision to test asymptomatic patients will be dependent on the availability of the testing resources. Testing resources, really, India, do we have the testing resources in India to test all the asymptomatics? I don't think so. We have the resources. Now, this is an unpublished data from the center where I work. The overall positivity rates in our center of all the samples tested is 1.6%. The positive with symptoms is 3.1%. Whereas positivity in asymptomatic high-risk contacts or the pre-transplant or the pre-procedure screen is 0.55%. So in my hospital, we initially started off with a targeted screening. Then we moved in between to a universal screening. And now sort of again, looking at these results, we are again moving back to a targeted screening. So as Dr. Ossie always says, and he is very fond of this, the number needed to treat or the number needed to diagnose one additional case among asymptomatic is 180. And the cost of diagnosing that additional case is 8,10,000 Indian national rupees. Do we have the resources to do that? I don't think so. The answer is yes. Now, what are the harms of asymptomatic testing? It leads to depletion of already limited resources, which we have, and there is a diversion of resources away from symptomatic patients. The test has a very low sensitivity, and false negative test many a times gives a false sense of security to the healthcare worker, and this would lead to breach in infection control practices, and they would not follow their infection control practices stringently. False positive may unnecessarily delay major time sensitive surgery, and definitely this recommendation is not cost effective. Now let's look at few of the guidelines. There were only few guidelines which went in my favor, and I cherry picked them happily and put them in my presentation. One of them was by ICMR. Look at the point 9. No emergency procedure for lack of test should be delayed. However, sample can be sent for testing if indicated as above, as mentioned in 1-8. 1-8, there is no mention of pre-surgical screening. So in India, I don't think so. ICMR allows for pre-surgical screening of asymptomatic patients. Also to note is the guidelines by the Indian Society of Anesthesiologists. They also do not mention COVID-19 routinely testing before surgery. These are guidelines from the Australia. They also follow a symptom-directed approach, and they do not do a universal testing before surgery. So the conclusion of my talks are, we should go for a targeted screening for symptoms is the way forward. The test is not foolproof. There are a lot of fallacies of the test. Definitely, it is not a cost-effective method. We should rather focus more on infection control practices, and there are no concerns of environmental contamination with asymptomatic carriages in the hospital if we are doing proper terminal cleaning of the hospitals. So with this clinical scenario, I would leave the talk and hand it over back to Dr. Swati. This is a 65-year-old male patient, very similar to what she had presented with, who comes to the hospital with anterior trochanteric fracture, referred to the orthopedic unit in your hospital. He is planned for open reduction internal fixation. As per guidelines, a pre-surgical SARS-CoV-2 PCR is negative. He undergoes surgery and is now in the post-operative ward. On post-operative day 5, the patient develops a surgical site infection and needs a debridement and a repeat surgery. So in the first scenario, would you do a SARS-CoV-2 PCR again? I don't know the answer, whether you can tell it, or neither of the guidelines tell that. So there is no correct answer to that question. Or in the scenario 2, you decide to test again and it is positive now. What next? Would you delay the surgery? He has got a surgical site infection. It can become an implant infection and an implant-related osteomyelitis. So it is a time-sensitive surgery. What would you do now? Conduct surgery using adequate PP and following ICP, probably that's what you would do. So if you could do the same thing in the beginning, you could have avoided doing this testing twice and saved a lot of finances doing that way. So with this, I leave and hand it over back to Dr. O.C. Abraham and Dr. Nambi. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Vikas. Very well argued, convincingly argued, I would say. If you listen to both the presentation, all the hallmarks of a very good ID physician are present in both Swati and Vikas. Eye for detail is the most important thing. Analyze the literature thoroughly. Picked up many details which an ordinary reader would have missed. Applying it, with making it contextually specific. Always concerned about the patient, always concerned about co-workers, always concerned about the money. So now back to you, Swati, for rebuttal. Please, we have a few more minutes. Please, let's say 2 minutes each for rebuttal. And finally, both of you have to come back with some kind of consensus statement. Unlike a playing field, we don't have winners. Both of you have argued very convincingly, I would say. So you have to come up with a consensus statement. Swati.
Thank you, Dr. Vikas, for such a wonderful debate. So, like for 80% of your slides, you were concerned about the sensitivity of the test. The very first disclosure of my presentation was, we are discussing ideal versus practical solution. Here, I'm not going to give you a solution which is ideal, which is going to pick 100% of your cases. But 70% sensitivity, I know it is not too good, but it is reasonably effective in telling you whether you are working in a safe environment or not. That's very first question, that is very first argument I would like to give you. Second argue you have, second your important concern was, in your own hospital, you spent almost 810,000 rupees behind testing, which got, which were not very much fruitful. Can you just tell me how much you are spending in giving universal precautions to your all OT healthcare staff without testing asymptomatic carriers? Third thing I would like to ask you is, I have some slides for this, is, see, none of the tests is 100% sensitive. There are all, everywhere there are loopholes in the testing as well as the strategies, whatever we do. So sensitivity of the screening test can be improved by proper training. And I don't mind in doing 2 negative tests for the high-risk surgeries, right? Which are, is going to involve more than 2 surgeons, too many healthcare workers, like cancer surgeries. So here I have a study supporting my argument. This is a reconstructed diagnostic sensitivity and specificity of the RT-PCR for COVID-19. They have taken mainly data from the China. And what they found is, by doing 2 negative, by doing 2 tests, 2 RT-PCR, the chances of false negativity can come down to 5%. So this is very important data, and I definitely will not hesitate in doing 2 negative PCR in high-risk cases. Now, throughout your presentation, I was wondering when you will come to the targeted testing. What are your targets? Whom are you actually testing? So in your counterfeit, I would like to know what are, who are your targets, right? Because when I'm considering India, some of the states, some of the cities, we are in a community transmission. So who is high risk for you and who is low risk for you? Either you should not be testing anyone or you should start testing everyone. Because here we are in a phase of community transmission. Can you tell me who is high risk among this population, who is not high risk among this population? We cannot say. So either you do the testing or you don't do the testing if you don't trust the test. But targeted testing, I doubt you will be losing more money if you do targeted testing in the current pandemic, which phase we are in right now. Third thing is cost effectiveness you thought about. Okay. What we will do with the saved money if we don't have healthcare workers to work, if we don't have hospitals who are working, which the hospitals which were shut down because of the increase in cases, because of this high-risk transmission, what we are going to tell, what we are going to show about the morbidity and mortality, which patients are going to face. See, here, with all your universal precautions, we can save healthcare workers, we can save co-patients. But what about the patient who is undergoing surgery? I know the available data is not that great. The numbers are not great. But what we are seeing in a routine population, non-surgery population, that the morbidity and mortality is high in patients who are having comorbidities, like let it be diabetes, hypertension. Surgery is a kind of stress. Surgery is a kind of comorbid condition. So don't you feel you will lose your patient in when you are trying to save the cost? And have you ever thought about the work efficiency of surgeons? I can maximum stay in the COVID area when I have to go to the ICU. Maximum, my maximum is hardly one and a half hour or 2 hours in that PPE. But surgeon has to be in that PPE with all his surgical skills reserved. Do you feel this is a good option to apply universal precaution for all the patients? I don't feel so. If you will see the first picture, this is a staff in a Singapore hospital. They have PAPR, but we are working in a government hospital where sometimes AC might not be working well. And if you want to try converting your OT into negative pressure room, they are suggesting stopping AC. Okay. Can you imagine being in this healthcare worker's position with all PPE on, all ACs off, and they are delivering the work with same efficiency level? I feel universal testing is the way to go. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Swati. Over to you, Vikas. Then we have to come up with a consensus statement.
So my rebuttal is regarding the cost effectiveness. She said that if you give PPE to all the staff in your who is there in your OT for every shift, then you would end up spending more money than what you save. So you only said that you would be happy to do two tests to improve the sensitivity of that test. In that case, the cost effectiveness goes for a toss. So if you are spending 9,000 rupees for testing a patient, and one PPE with a N95 mask cost 600 to 900 rupees in the market. If you take two surgeons, two anesthetists, two scrub nurses, and one ward boy, that is seven healthcare workers in the OT, and the PPE cost would still be much lower than what you are spending by doing testing twice. This is the maximum number which you can think, or even take eight healthcare workers in the OT. So that's my argument to your first point. Second point you raised was, who is the target population? Target population is anyone who is having any symptoms, anyone who is coming from a high prevalence area, more than 10%. I think that is written in the guidelines, which I shared and you also shared of the IDSA, that anyone from coming from a high prevalence or a hotspot or a hot zone where the prevalence in the community is more than 10%, he is my target. The third target is an asymptomatic contact of a positive contact. Those would be my targeted persons to be tested before surgery.
Thank you. Any consensus? Can you guys come up with a consensus?
Sir, I think we should change our strategies as we progress through our pandemic, because whatever targeted population you have suggested, I don't think we'll be able to pinpoint in coming few weeks. So strategies should change as the pandemic go forward.
Absolutely. The strategy should change as the pandemic goes on and we have more data and about the prevalence of the disease in the asymptomatics and the test performance of that test in that asymptomatic population. So once we have that information, we would be more wiser to apply the things, whatever we have discussed. Targeted population, and we have to sort of find a balance as of now between universal testing and a targeted population. So that's what I would say.
Thank you very much, two wonderful speakers. I will conclude by mentioning few points. Swati argued that we have community transmission. We need to protect healthcare workers. We need to remove blindfolds and the difficulties in working in a PPE throughout and saving PPE. Vikas argued about poor performance characteristics of the test, very poor negative value or unknown negative predictive value, and lack of cost effectiveness, and therefore he likes targeted testing. Like both of them said, the truth lies somewhere in the middle. In our hospital, because of requests from the surgeons, the current policy is that anybody who undergoes, who is posted for a surgery under GA and who is likely to require ICU care postoperatively will have a test done. But that does not mean that you can get away with usage of PPE, full PPE, including respiratory protection inside the theater. Only time will tell what is the truth. So, over to you, Nambi. Thank you.
I think that was a very good debate. And probably I think many cities in India have not reached that high level of prevalence, more than 10%, to do universal testing. I know that Chennai, Ahmedabad, Pune and Mumbai have very high prevalence as of now. The most important thing is the access to the testing and the turnaround time for the reports. So for example, in CMC Vellore, if they're able to do it, it means that they have the lab in-house. What happens to the small cities, small towns, where there is a send-out test? So you're going to wait for the reports before doing for the test. For example, a state like Telangana, there's no private lab which does the test. All they have is the government-sponsored, government labs where the test is being done. So when the access to the test is a problem, then you would always target the symptomatics, people with pneumonias, they would be your top priorities in trying to do the test. So I don't think there's any right answers currently for this situation. Even in our institute, when we started, we didn't think that a routine testing is required. That was our practice until 2 weeks ago. And then with inputs from other people, let it be the management or the surgeons and anesthetists, for all the apprehensions, we had to kind of change or tweak our practice to include do the surge PCR pre-op for all patients. But I believe, I'm not sure if that is the right one. And probably we need to analyze our data and trying to understand if there are 1,000 pre-op screenings, how many we picked up so that we can frame a policy. One of our fellows is actually looking into the data so that probably another 10 days, we'll have some data on that, saying that what will be the yield of doing this in the long run. Is it something that is feasible? And with that, I think probably we can end the session. And thanks, Swati, for doing this at a very, very short notice. And thanks, Vikas, for doing it again. And I think enjoy the debate. It was just not fun. It was statistics, facts, and analysis of the literature that is available, in spite of being in hot zones, both Ahmedabad and Delhi. And yes, thanks for the nice show. And as usual, OC, thanks for his excellent oration in terms of analysis of the literature. And thank you, viewers, for joining on Saturday afternoon. And people who have joined in late can always view it on the YouTube channel. All you have to do is type SIDS webinars, and then all these lectures will be available in the SIDS website, which is www.sidsindia.org. And that website also has content relevant to the COVID scenario with relevant literature. And we will meet you again next Friday and Saturday. Next Friday is going to be a three-way debate. So we've had two-way debates this Friday and Saturday. Next Friday is going to be a three-way debate on what is the treatment for COVID. Should we go with antivirals or should we use anti-inflammatory agents like steroids or the IL-6 or the JAK2 inhibitors? Or no, nothing works. Just leave the patient and then most probably they'll get better. So that's a kind of a three-way debate. That is something that we are doing next Friday, 3 to 4 p.m. See you all. Have a nice weekend. Take care. Stay safe. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Nambi.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Swati.
Bye, Dr. Swati.
Thank you, sir.
Very good.